Conversation with Ronnie Gilbert covers a lot of ground, but focuses primarily on the folk music from the 1940s. And Ronnie, what was your connection with folk music in the 1940s? What was it like?
See, when you say the 40s to me, the Weavers did not actually begin until the late 40s. I mean, we did, in fact, we did Pete Seeger and People's Songs began in 1946, right after he came back from the war.
Right.
But the Weavers came out of the Hootenanny, People's Songs Hootenanny movement, and we actually didn't sing together. The four of us, as the Weavers, didn't sing together until about 40. My recollection is 47,
right.
And then gave ourselves the names the Weavers, and then but we didn't actually begin to record the big commercial success until 1950. So all that time beforehand was a kind of, as you say, it was a kind of revving up to a very interesting time, which is the McCarthy era, and the Weavers came about at around the same time. You know,
that was a very fortunate series of events.
It wasn't accidental. It was quite, it's quite remarkable.
Well, it's a similar era today where people are afraid to say things out of fear of not having a voice or losing their voice. We live in similar times.
Don't we? Yeah.
But the development and what led into that, led up to you singing with the Weavers, I think is an important story. And maybe we could talk about that.
Well, I can talk about it from as far as I'm concerned personally.
Okay,
I can do that.
So were you coming? I guess you were in your 20s in the 40s.
I was born in 1926. So yeah, that's right.
So what kind of folk music did you hear growing up? Did your parents sing to you? Were you listening to folk songs on the radio, or what kind of?
You wouldn't have heard very much folk song on the radio when I was a kid. That was one of the things that happened when the Weavers came along, and was a big thing, was that we put folk songs on the radio.
Right.
I mean, there might have been a little bit. I think the very earliest of the recognizable folk song names that I ever heard actually was about 1944, and when Freddie and I both the same age, and we met in a summer camp in New Jersey, and both of us knew or just heard Burl Ives.
Right. Who is it?
Crack corn and I don't care, and Richard Dyer Bennett, wonderful lutenist and tenor. That was about it. I mean, maybe somebody would have played those songs on the radio, but I wouldn't have known where.
So the folk songs that people were singing were really songs that you learned in camp, or songs that you might have
right.
heard.
That's right. Camp was one good place to have heard some folk songs.
Or Susan Reed, most of the songs that she heard were from her family and her family's friends.
Yeah, but that wasn't me. I came from an Eastern European Jewish family, and though I did hear some songs, some maybe folk songs from my mother, they would have been in Yiddish, and they were, and I've since learned that they actually came from plays. They were part of theater.
That's interesting.
And my father, who was born in this country, was crazy about the contemporary pop songs of the day, which who knows where they came from. Yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today.
Well, that's a folk song,
Well, maybe it's a folk song, but I think it probably came from a musical or something like that.
Right, Tin Pan Alley or the 20,
right.
Yeah, but popular music.
Music. And then the first songs that I heard that the first time I ever heard country music, for instance, was I was about 11 years old. My family sent me to some cousins who live in Springfield, Missouri, and I heard the country music on the radio all day long. So that's how I got my ear got familiar with that kind of music. But as a budding singer, I didn't really hear any folk songs until, except for the, you know, except for the ones that I mentioned, till the Spanish Civil War. That was in the 30s. That was the late 30s, 1938 or so. The songs of the Spanish Civil War that Pete Seeger and several other people that I knew recorded. Six Songs for Democracy, you know that?
Yeah.
That record that you get from the Smithsonian, I think.
So that was a powerful impact on your...
The most powerful impact. Those songs were the most powerful impact on me politically because of the war, which was the first time that a civilian population was bombed. You know, nowadays it's so common that we don't even gasp anymore, but in those days... There were photographs of women and children running with their children as the bombs were exploded over their heads.
It's no less horrifying today, but
horrifying when you think about it. But who thinks about it? It's done all the time, you know.
Right.
But in those days, it was brand new, and the Italian fascist Air Force was testing out their bombs on the civilian population. And as a child, that was a tremendous impact on me. I mean,
so you would read about it in the papers. You would be talking about it with your parents, or
that's right.
You wouldn't be seeing it on TV because they didn't
have
TV.
There wasn't any TV yet. Yeah.
And so in the 30s, Seeger's was a force in presenting political music, and that obviously had a tremendous impact on you.
I didn't hear Pete until, actually, I can tell you a little bit about my personal introduction to American folk music.
Okay.
It was in Washington, D.C., when I was working in the government at age 16. My mother was sick. I dropped out of school. I went down there. It was World War II. It was time to, you could get a job, even a kid who didn't have any skills whatsoever, as myself, got a job as a temp, an office temp, and I went down there and worked. And while I was there in this place where I was living, I heard these people singing, and I went down to the basement, and there they were, this group of people having a rehearsal of some kind. Got introduced to them. They were called the Priority Ramblers.
Okay, great name.
Priority Ramblers. And among them was, do you know the name Tom Glaser?
Yes, he's a very prolific, probably
was,
one of the most prolific folk singers that ever walked the planet. He probably has more recordings. He's probably done more commercial work than anybody.
Yeah, he did a lot of children's music. And so, well, Tom was a member of the Ramblers. He was one of the Priority Ramblers. And Bernie Asbell, do you know the name?
No.
Bernard Asbell? He's a historian. He wrote a couple of very good books. He taught at University in Pennsylvania, Penn State or something. I can't remember the name of the university. But he was a member of that group. He was a young guy with a guitar and playing music, and his wife was there, his wife of the time, Millie Asbell. So that was the group, and a very close, somebody who became my very, very close friend. If you ever saw the film, Wasn't That a Time, at the beginning of The Picnic, a woman with buttons, with the political buttons all over her vest. You're my baby, she says about me, my baby. Well, I was 16 years old. She's a few years older than me, and she kind of took me under her wing into the group.
So the Priority.
Her name was Jackie Gibson at the time.
Oh,
Jackie,
yes.
Alperno.
Okay. But the Priority Ramblers, well, that was like a homespun group, sort of in a hootenanny kind of setting.
It wasn't. There were no hootenannies then. There were no concerts. There were a group of people who got together to sing, and then you found little events to sing at. You know, probably the same kind of things that maybe in a slightly larger scale we did later on.
Right.
But I sang with them at some little events, and sometimes just with Jackie, and sometimes with the whole group. It was a wonderful group, and what they were doing was singing. The core of their music, core of their songs, were really from the Almanac Singers, and that, you know who that was, Pete Seeger and Lee Hayes and Woody Guthrie and several other people.
Was it the same style as the Almanacs, or were they independently, you know, connected by a different, you know, I lost my train of thought there. It wasn't the Almanacs, but a similar style, just a loose-knit group of people singing political songs?
The Priority Ramblers?
Yeah.
Yes, that's right. Okay. That's exactly right. They knew, some of them Alan Lomax was a close friend.
Yes.
And what the precise connections were that got them together with Pete and Lee and so on, I don't know. They were a bit older than me. They were anywhere from 7 to 10 years older than I. So I just came in as a kind of a newcomer into this group as a kid. I was just a kid.
A new kid on the block.
Yeah, so I learned subsequently something about them and how they came, you know, who they were and all that. But I came in to sing, and that's what I did. So they sang very much like the early Weavers, folk songs that were changed to sing about the times, you know, veterans coming home, not being able to find a place to live, the high prices, Jim Crow was a big thing, you know, racism was a big thing to sing about, sing against.
So was that considered?
And then ordinary, mostly country songs of Johnson Boys was raised in the ashes, didn't know how to court me.
Well, you know, the country music, when you were listening to that in Missouri, that sort of has some folk roots in it, more so than it does now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So they really were the folk songs of the land.
Right.
But singing in Washington, D.C. with the Priority Ramblers, how far did that go in terms of having an impact on people living in Washington?
Oh, who knows? I have no idea. I wouldn't have known that. I didn't question those things. I just, they're singing. I can sing, and I love the people, and I love the songs. And
so you soaked it up.
I soaked it up, you know. That was what I did.
And Tom Glaser must have
and
been.
And I don't think there was a huge, how could there have been? There must have been, you know, I actually never did question, I should have done this. I never did question Jackie, who remained my friend all these many years, where and how and what kind of impression they made. I don't really know. I mean, you know, so a lot of them are gone by now. Bernie's gone, Tom's gone, Jackie's alive, but, you know. Anyway, I'll use that information, and next time I talk to Jackie, I'll ask her if she can remember.
There you go. And so is that group what imbued a sense of sort of political awareness and political, I don't want to say radicalism, but...
They're hardly radical, but, yeah, political awareness, social conscience.
Right.
Yeah, that's for sure.
That
came naturally to me. You know, my mother came to this country when she was 16 years old, and she had already had a life as a child worker in Poland, in Warsaw.
Yeah.
And she her life included experience as a unionist, and the union in those days in Europe, among the Jewish dressmakers and needle trades workers, was a very cultural organization. They had singing and plays and whatnot, and she came with that notion, with that idea. So all of my life there was no separation between music and politics and music and what was going on in the world. And in our piano bench, along with the finger exercises and all of that stuff, was a little book called The Little Red Songbook, which was the book that the industrial workers of the world, the Wobblies, put out with songs by Joe Hill and, you know, all kinds of stuff. Did you talk about that at all in your program yet?
A little bit, not too much, because I'm trying to bring it out of the people that I talk to.
Oh, yeah.
Was that an under the table kind of book that wasn't in the popular
Under the Table? I wouldn't say that. What it was in the pocket. It was a tiny little book. It was big. It was made deliberately big enough for workers who traveled around, and it was the industrial workers were largely traveling people who went from lumber camp to railroad jobs and things like that, and they're itinerant workers all around the country.
Right.
And originally, the songs from these worker poets like Joe Hill and T-Bone Slim, and originally they were on little cards, and they'd put them out on little cards, and these guys would carry them around from one place to another in union meetings and all of that. Eventually, they put them in this little book called The Little Red Songbook, and they continued to publish that all the way through into the 40s. So we had to come. My mother picked up a copy at one of her meetings, which is the ILGWU, the International Ladies Garment Workers Union, and she carried it home. And we used to sing together, "Hallelujah, I'm a bum, hallelujah, bum again." You know, it was the only time I was allowed to use the word bum. Bad word.
So that was a very popular union in the 40s that a lot of people, you know, that workers' movement was.
Oh, it was a hugely important union, very important union, and they were persecuted like crazy by the government. And but it still exists today. It still lives today. And you know who's a great proponent and member of that is Utah Phillips.
Yeah, I've seen him many times talking about that. But you know, you don't get a sense of how real it was.
I mean, I know that from history since I am grown and have looked it up and, you know, and talked to people about it, but I didn't know that when I was a kid. All I knew was this little book of songs, you know.
And they were powerful. They were parables of hymns and
exactly.
songs that people sang
exactly.
at churches. Not many Jewish songs in there.
Not many.
So it must be interesting hearing.
No, I don't think there were any.
Hearing your Jewish mother sing these hymns.
It was great. My mother used to sing those things that when they were out on strike, the ILGWU, they would sing them, "Hold the fort, for we are coming." It was wonderful.
So your political roots and your social justice and, you know, workers ideas really come from your parents and come from the
from my mother.
Yeah,
specifically
yeah.
my mother.
Yeah, yeah. That's
my
that's,
father was totally apolitical. Yeah.
Well, that added to the mix, I'm sure too. But that's interesting. So the Little Red School Books had a big impact.
Yeah, Little Red Songbook. Yeah.
Right, the school songbook. All right. So that was when you were in Washington. You were 16 years old. That's a long ways from New York, living on your own.
Well, yes, that's right.
Difficult times.
Yeah, well, my mother was the mainstay of the financially of the family, and she had gotten very sick, and she was recovering from major surgery in the hospital.
Yeah.
In those days, they didn't get you up very fast, so I kind of had to pitch in. And the best place to do that was to go to where they didn't have enough people to do the jobs, and that was Washington D.C.
Right. So, how long were you in Washington with the Priority Ramblers?
Well, I was with them for a year, and then I went back to high school to finish up high school down there. When my mother became well and came down there to live. And so I had a year with them, and then had to leave because I was I had to go back to school. But you see that as soon as school was over, that was 1944, I went straight back up to New York, and there connected with some of the people who also had come from New York and were living, had left. You know, the war was over, so we went home, and. That's what happened with Pete. The war was over. He went home and went back to New York, and he met up with Lee Hayes, who had been part of the Almanac Singers before the war.
Right. Did you know them?
I did not know them.
Yeah.
I did not know them at all. Okay. I knew them only through the songs that the Priority Ramblers had mentioned were their songs.
So there must have been a network of folk singers, because the you know they didn't. I'm sure the Priority Ramblers didn't have records out, or they probably didn't.
To my knowledge, no. I don't think there were any recordings.
Or play on radio, but and the Almanac Singers, I don't think were on radio.
I don't think so. I can't swear to that, but I doubt it.
And,
I doubt it very much.
You know, the recordings are very limited. I'm not sure, you know, I would think that they were fairly limited.
Oh, yes, extremely limited.
So what was the contact between those groups? What was the means of networking?
Well, it wasn't really so much about groups. I know the Almanac Singers had traveled a lot when they were at their prime. They did a lot of traveling. I'm always surprised to learn how much how they did travel. I know they were on the radio. There were I don't know how many broadcasts, probably not very many.
Right.
But they had gone on the radio. They had done quite a lot of traveling before they split up and went into the some of them went into the service. When America got into the war, they then split up, and Woody went into the Coast Guard, I think, wasn't it the Coast Guard or Merchant Marine?
Merchant Marine, yeah.
Yeah, with Cisco Houston, and
that's a great story in itself.
Yeah, yeah. So and Pete went into the Army, and when the war was over, they naturally gravitated back to wherever it was that they were together, and it happened to be New York. And that's when Pete started People's Songs, which started the folk music era, really.
So what was People's Songs?
Oh, People's Songs was an organization that they put together to try to promote the singing of folk music. And they promoted concerts, which were called Hootenannies, right?
Were they strictly political concerts?
Well, they were strictly political. They were political in the sense that the people involved in that were very socially conscious people.
Yeah.
So naturally they used the songs. They Lee Hayes, for instance, was a knight from a family from Arkansas, and his father was an itinerant Methodist preacher. And Lee, who left home quite early, I think also about 16, I think, had a background of very, very interesting, socially aware, political education at Commonwealth College, and met up there with a preacher I don't remember what denomination, he might have been Methodist, I'm not sure, who they used to call the Red Preacher, Claude Williams, and with Claude Williams, Lee as a youngster did what Claude Williams did, which was he would sing to, he would turn hymn songs into socially aware and use them for the labor struggles among the agricultural workers, the tobacco workers, and so forth. So that came with the territory.
So following the tradition of Joe Hill in the
exactly, yeah. Exactly,
yeah.
Yes.
It's an amazing collection of individuals that came together in the 40s in New York City.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
In terms of not political, the country singers, were they a part of People's Songs too? And were there any that come to mind?
Do you have anybody in mind?
I really don't. I'm just kind of trying to figure out I know who the main figures were. But I don't know who may have been also been a part of the, that aren't
well,
in common
you,
knowledge
you
today.
You said yourself, just dropped out of my head.
Susan Reed.
There were, let me see, some of the other people that were around, whether they were part of People's Song. Oh, you know what happened, actually? There must have been several. What happened was that Pete Seeger got involved in the campaign, more than got involved. He actually was very strongly part of that campaign to elect Henry Wallace president on the Progressive Party ticket in 1948. That was the first election in 14 years after FDR died. Harry Truman had become vice president, had dropped the bomb on Hiroshima. Practically within days of his having been elected, or at least weeks, not elected. He wasn't elected. He came because FDR died.
Right.
So it was a very, very important election. It was an election, you know, people ask me, have you ever been in an election that was more passionate than the one between Bush and Kerry? And I said, oh, yeah, 1948.
Going back a step to the dropping the bomb, the atomic bombs on Japan, that was not a good thing. I mean, it ended the war, right? I mean,
are you asking a question?
It's a rhetorical question. I know that it was horrific.
What's good about incinerating 400,000 people?
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I can't imagine anybody thinking that's good. Oh, yes, it ended the war. Well, that's a nice racist thing to say. We got rid of a bunch of Japs, right?
Right, but people did say that, and I'm sure there was.
I know that people said that.
Yeah.
Right. They probably, some of them still do.
Well, I think people move. I think that there's a different way of looking at it. People look at it differently that live through it now.
Okay, let them look at it any way they want to. I think it's horrible. I thought it was horrible, and those of us the people I knew thought it was horrible and think
right.
it's horrible. So.
Right. Well, there's no question that it was horrible, but it supposedly ended. It was the only means of ending the war.
Well, there's another way to look at it. The Japanese were ready to surrender. They were already ready to surrender. A lot of people think now, having looked back at it, historians think this was the way that Truman took to scare the bejesus out of the Russians.
Right.
And that was it. He came in. He had some big shoes to fill. For FDR, he said so himself,
right.
And he came in as one of these little guys, and he was a little guy politically. He had very little background, had no background internationally. He had very little real sense of international or any kind of, you know. He came from he was a ward politician from Missouri, you know.
Right.
And he decided he had to be a big guy, right? And he said right away, we've got to get tough with the Russians. We have to show them. We have to teach them a lesson. He was quoted saying that. And that was the first lesson he taught, was the dropping of the bomb. So that's the way I see it.
Yeah.
And a lot of, not just I see it, but many historians see it that way now. So that was what it was about. And I don't even think I even saw it that way. All I could see was, oh, my God. Have we really come to that, that we could do that to human beings? Yeah, we came to it.
Well, you know, it's common practice today just to blow up a city and to kill, you know, innocent people. We see it on TV. We see the powers that be doing that today without any no end in sight.
Well, you see, it really all started in Spain.
Yes,
that's where the whole. How come? I mean, how is it possible that we weren't on and on, just revolted by this idea of dropping a bomb on a civilian population? We weren't. It got, you know, the politicians, the politicos got hold of, oh my, that's a way to go. And I mean, I know it's oversimplifying, but that's where it started, right? So, then and there. And the songs of the Abraham Lincoln Brigade, the songs from Spain, the reason that they have remained as strong in people's memories and people's hearts is that that's what they were about. They were about trying to stop Hitler and Mussolini in their tracks, and we didn't. We let them go on. We let them go on. We let them go on, and the beginning of that was the Second World War.
Yes, that's true.
So that's why those songs, you see, were so important. When I say that I can talk about those songs, because that was the beginning of my personally, my political identification was the Spanish Civil War. I was 11 years old, 12 years old.
Right. Well, a lot of things combined in you. So Henry Wallace promised something different. There was something.
Well, Henry Wallace was a disciple of FDR. He had been the Secretary of Agriculture at one point, and he was he wrote things like The Century of the Common Man. And he had ideas like, you know, his idea was, we need to fight communism. Well, the way to do that is to make sure that all working people have a living wage and decent working conditions. Now tell me, is that not a concept? So that was what he thought, and he thought the quarrels with the Soviet Union need to be settled via the United Nations, which was new at the time. And we had great hopes, people had great hopes for the United Nations. Instead of fighting it out in this so-called Cold War, which was so dangerous, and especially with the bomb as the high card, you know, that was his way of thinking. And so, of course, to leftists and progressives and people of peace, and there was a huge coalition to form the Progressive Party, but it was a coalition made up of everything from kind of liberals to left liberals to all the way across the strata to even to communists. And by the time the election campaign got going, the anti-communist was so virulent, the anti-red thing, and that's another thing that we owed to Harry Truman, the loyalty oath and the boards and all of that, was so virulent that liberals began to leave the coalition because of the Communist Party. And pretty soon, all the liberal organizations left, and then the CIO, which was then the great industrial union that had been sponsoring it, they left. So there was no, you know, went to pieces, and did not do very well. But the election campaign itself was marvelous, and
the idea,
full of singing, and Pete Seeger was really, Pete Seeger and People's Songs were at the head of it.
He was moved to do that. It was a great time to make some changes. I mean, you were coming out of something that was, you know, had worldwide, it was a horrific situation, and you had the opportunity to look like it presented itself to change things.
Yeah, to move toward, you know, the United Nations song, "Together Fight for Victory, a Free New World." Well, we got the Free New World, all right.
So that was a singing campaign.
Oh, gosh, I'll say. Yeah, I do a little program. I perform a little program in which part of it is the songs from the Henry Wallace, from the Progressive Party campaign. I keep wondering, why doesn't the Green Party sing?
Well, you know, what came out of that was political activism and people who were concerned about peace and freedom kind of went ahead to go underground.
Yeah, that's right.
And
Is there a red under your bed? You better look around before you settle down. That's right.
You know, and
1940s song.
Yes. All right. So, what happened? What lit it all off with folk music and coming up into the Weavers? How did that?
Well, what happened was the Weavers were trying to making not exactly a living, but, you know, well, we were trying to, at the point came that we realized which was very early on when we first started, so we came out of the Hootenanny movement.
Right.
We sang together at a Hootenanny and just put some stuff together to sing, and we knew right away that we had a wonderful sound, and it was an odd combination of people, an odd combination of voices, and it added up to something way bigger than any one of us, you know.
So were people very responsive to where you played?
Yeah, we played at Hootenannies.
Yeah.
That's what we played. And then as we got to be a little bit known in that circle, in the folk music, folk people song circle and all that, people's songs folded because of, when the Henry Wallace campaign, when the election, Pete came back. Pete and Lee had built up a very, very good organization. It was national. People like Bernie Asbell would travel the country and sell subscriptions to people's songs.
So that would be like a concert series? Or?
Yeah, do concerts here and there, sing for unions, do this, and groups started up in Los Angeles and Chicago and so on, and so there was they always operating on a tiny, tiny budget. They were putting out this song book.
So it really was.
It became Sing Out, you know.
It was a grassroots organization.
Grassroots organization.
But nationwide.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, who were some of the artists that were singing around the country
Well, Bernie Asbell and his wife, Millie, were among them, and I don't know who all else. But I happen to know about Bernie because he was a priority rambler, so I recognize
right.
his name.
You know? No, but people like, was Lead Belly a part of that? Was Josh White a part
Lead
of that?
Lead Belly was not. Lead Belly was, Lead Belly was supported and loved and by all of these people, but Lead Belly was brought to New York by Alan Lomax and his father.
Right, and he was his own.
A whole other story.
It is. It's quite a story. But was he an active part of performing? Was he really nationally known in that era?
Not at that time, no. No.
So you helped, you know, the success of the Elite Weavers really propelled him to a different state.
I don't know. I mean, it all happened around the same time, so
yeah.
I can't say that. It happened all just around the same time. I don't know when his recordings began to come out. You probably know more about that than I do. But he played at the Village Vanguard, you know, which is the place where the Weavers began their commercial career.
Right.
And so in New York, he became known. He played for rent parties and things like that. So
right.
in that way, he was part of the political, you know, the political folk thing was very close. It was very connected. And as you must be able to see that's how it was connected. It wasn't as if it was a some kind of a conspiracy. It's just a very natural thing.
But he was an important part of that mix of in New York at that
exactly,
time.
Exactly, he was. Yeah,
Was Josh White a New York person at that point also?
Josh White also was a New York person, and I'm not sure about this, but I think Josh White might have at one point been part of the Almanac Singers. Almanac Singers were funny, you know, people came and went all the time.
Right.
They'd turn around, there'd be a new group of people there. It was Pete and Lee were basic and Woody Guthrie, but Woody came and went. Woody was a come and go person.
Right, he was his own, was his own kind of...
Yeah, but then there was Butch Hawes and there were, you know, there were other people in the group whose names don't come to mind very quickly, but... They were a coming and going group, and they did come and go a lot.
Right.
So I don't know whether Josh White was in that as part of that group, or whether he may have come in, sung occasionally. I really don't know.
There's a couple of Lead Belly recordings that I have where Josh White is clearly playing the guitar.
Oh yeah.
And you know, you hear Lead Belly sing, and it's, you know, it's stunning in itself. But then you hear this a different sound, and it you realize that it's, you know, it's a different kind of artistry in a performance.
They did play together. They were actually I don't know whether they were personal friends or musical friends or what kind of friends they were, but they actually played together at the Village Vanguard. What you might have heard is some recordings that were made there.
Right. I heard about the stories of Josh White playing Cafe Society. Do you have
Cafe Society? Yeah, downtown. Yeah.
Do you have any idea what that was? What that was about? From your...
About his playing there?
No.
Well,
about
Cafe
Society
was a club like the Village Vanguard. There was two Cafe Societies. There's one downtown and one uptown in the fancy 50s in those days. One downtown, he might very well have played there, or he might have played at the Uptown one. I don't know.
Was that any different than the Vanguard, or it was just a club where people played?
It was the Cafe Society was a little more upscale, tiny bit more upscale. It was bigger club. It was bigger. There was more room. There was, as I remember it, we played there, but you know there were. We played it on a bill with somebody else who was kind of well-known in the entertainment world. But that was downtown. That was Barney Josephson's place downtown.
Yeah.
And then there was Cafe Society uptown, which was, I think, Max Gordon. No, I'm mixing up something else.
Yeah, I think.
The Blue Angel. I'm thinking about the Blue Angel. No, there were two Cafe Societies. The one downtown was the one that I'm familiar with, or that Weavers played, and that other people.
So in the early days, the Weavers would play there?
No, not until after we were the famous Weavers, then we played there.
The famous Weavers, yes.
We were only relatively famous at that point, but we did play there, yeah.
So
our way up the scale.
Yes, up the food chain.
Up the food chain.
Or something like that. In terms of, like, popular performing folk artists of that era, I can think of Burl Ives, who was, you know, I guess would be a superstar.
Oh, Burl Ives was part of the Almanacs at times, yeah.
But he was also touring all over the world. He was making recordings. He was probably the most famous, or I would call them a popular folk singer of that day.
I think so.
Is there anybody else that you mentioned? John Jacob Niles.
No, Richard Dyer Bennett.
Richard Dyer Bennett.
Wonderful, wonderful singer. And then he was the other recording folk singer that most of us who cared about folk music at that point were interested in. He did wonderful records of folk songs in a very different style, you know, in a more cultured practice style. He was a lutenist. He's a wonderful, wonderful, played the lute beautifully. And he had a very, very fine tenor voice. He was a trained singer.
Right. It was a very high-pitched. Mm-hmm. Was he popular?
Oh yes. He did concerts. He played the Village Vanguard very successfully.
Right. Were you going to nightclubs and actively seeing a lot of folk music in that time?
I was not much of a nightclub goer. I was.
I don't know where
else. I was a working girl. I didn't have any money to do that. But I did. I remember seeing Josh White at the Village Vanguard. I went to see him.
Right.
Yeah.
And but it's interesting. So that was a really a different level of performance than you were coming from. You were headed that way.
You mean me personally?
Yeah.
Headed that way. Well, because I was, because of the Weavers. I mean, I got into the once the Weavers began, we began to do Oscar Brand. You know that name, Oscar?
Yeah, I'm using him as a resource for a lot of things.
Oh, I see. Well, he has his radio program. He had a WNYC in New York City radio program, and the Weavers would sing on that program. You know, we generally got to be known in the New York area. I mean,
yeah. It's
just pretty much New York. And when we finally went to work at the Village Vanguard, the big surprise was how very popular we became. We got wonderful reviews, and people began to trek down to the Village Vanguard to see this great group, you know, and all of that sort of thing. And that's from out of that we got discovered by, I love that word, discovered, by Gordon Jenkins from Decca Records.
Put it all on the map. Beatrice Lilly had a great line for when all the things come together, the magic comes together and the audience is responding. She would say, "The wand is on."
That's lovely.
Let me ask you about, there's one more question I wanted to ask you about. Were you doing other? I've heard rumors or stories that you were doing other types of singing. Were you primarily going to be a singer come heck or high water? I mean, is that what you were striving for?
I don't know what the other kind of singing is.
Well, singing. Somewhere I saw a reference that you were singing on WOR, which is more of.
I was a child. I was 11 years old, 12 years old.
You were a child?
13 years old, yeah. I was a children's radio program.
Oh, you got to tell me about that.
Well, a friend of my mother's, the daughter of a friend of my mother's, knew that I loved to sing and that I was, and she'd heard me, I don't know where she'd heard me sing, but I was one of these kids that whatever opportunity came along, whether it was just a ride on the subway train with my girlfriends, you know, would be singing. And so she heard on the radio that this weekly children's radio program was auditioning people for choir. So she sent a card in and put my name on it. And so I got my mother got a note to bring me in for this audition. and I didn't know anything about it, you know. But my mother thought, okay, well, let's see what happens. And I went and took the audition with great fear, I must say, and got into this choir. And I sang in this choir for years afterwards. You know, that was my weekly singing work.
So what was the name of the choir?
Well, the program was Bob Emery's Rainbow House.
Oh, wow. Okay. So Bob Emery.
Bob Emery was the person who was in charge of that. Not a nice man, believe me.
No.
But the choir was the Rainbow House Choir. The choir had a wonderful conductor. He went on, I understood later on, to do, I think he lived in Massachusetts or went to Massachusetts and did a lot of work with children's orchestras and choruses there. That's what I was told. I don't know much more about it. Dolph Martin, his name was.
So that was his mission.
That was his name. And it was a wonderful choir. We did everything from there. See, you just reminded me. We did a lot of folk songs in that choir, but kind of Richard Dyer Bennett type folk songs.
Well, more traditional songs.
Yeah, traditional and, you know, things that could be arranged for choir and that sort of thing. Yeah.
Yeah. So, well, that brings us up to 1950. Everyone knows what happened in 1950, so I don't even feel compelled to go there. But if there's anything you want to touch on.
No. No.
But, you know, the 40s were a remarkable series of dynamics came together and really impacted the 60s and the 70s. I mean, that's where really what you were doing, where it really came into a fusion, I guess. I don't even know how you would describe what happened, but it was a tremendous time and you had tremendous impact.
You know, it was tremendous. It was such a time of hope, and it was such a contradiction, you know. You mentioned it yourself. It was such a time of hope. This terrible war was over. We had every reason to think, to believe that the world, that we were going to have this marvelous world. We had the United Nations was this hugely important thing that had happened in the world. You know, one world, FDR used to say, one world, we must, one world. There was the song Passing Through that was a great favorite of Henry Wallace's. I was at Franklin Roosevelt's side just the day before he died. He said, one world must come out of World War II. Well, that was the point. That was what everybody hoped for. That's what we dreamed of, this one world that would come out of World War II. Well, the war was hardly over when the United States and the Soviet Union began to... the Soviet Union, which was our ally, you know, began to fight, to duke it out about who was going to run Europe.
Right. Well, you know, from what I'm reading about the Soviet Union and the Cold War, they were not the nicest. Well, we weren't either, but they weren't doing the nicest things to.
Come on, who was nice?
Yeah, I mean,
who was nice? You know, it wasn't about being nice. That was what was so horrible. It was about who was going to win, who was going to take over, who was going to do what.
Right.
I mean, there was definitely a move towards socialism in Europe, in parts of Europe. That's been going. That didn't happen with the Soviet Union. That happened a long time before the Soviet Union. You know that people were looking for a different way of life, a different way, a different economic way of life, a different way to live, different way to not to have to fight wars anymore, different way to not to have to have depressions. That wasn't about the Soviet Union. That happened a long time before. But it was always a battle between forces that wanted that and forces that knew there was a lot to be made out of having the kind of systems that did exist, you know. So we've got it now. We've had it all along. And it was particularly poignant after World War II because of the terrible devastation of World War II.
Right.
You know, so there was a huge amount of passion involved in all of that, and that was what was wonderful about that time, a kind of loving passion, I would say, that's what drew me, was kind of a lovingness, a passion for loving, a passion for being friends, you know, that came out of that time and the struggles of that time. And that's why it was so, I think, it was such a fruitful time creatively.
I think you hit the nail on the head. You've had a lot of time to think about it. And you have the intellect and the experience to put it into perspective like that. We don't have that hope today. You know, there's no passion that's propelling us into the world.
Hey, could we have dreamed of Cindy Sheehan 5 years ago? Even a year ago?
Well, I think she's a powerful person and doing something amazing, but
people are constellating around that love, around that particular kind of power, that particular kind of, well, I have to say, mother love, really constellating. So, there are people, because we don't read it in the media. The media is the toy of big business, honey.
Yeah.
Face it. And big business is on the side of, not on the side of peace. Not on the side of peace. Anyway.
Right.
At least most. I mean, I can't say that for sure, because I'm beginning to read about interesting things on the internet about some big business who feels quite differently. Anyway, we won't get into that.
Yeah, but how do we embrace and how do we find hope from people like Cindy Sheehan and what they're doing? Because you know, if you listen to the radio, you watch.
Well, that's the trouble. Yeah. Go to the internet. Get your news from the internet. Stop getting it from TV. You're not going to get it.
There you go. So the internet is the people's voice or an alternative voice?
Absolutely. It can be anybody's voice. That's the great thing about it. But if you want to know, go to the internet. Get online lists like Truth Out, for instance. Get online things like Move On. Get stuff like that. If you do that, then you begin to see that there is something going on in this country other than what you see in the media. You're not going to see anything in the media. Forget it. It's tied up.
Absolutely, absolutely. You've had a life. You have a lot of experience. It's the people's voice. It really is. I think you have a lot of insight. Is there any way that people could see you talk? I know that you do some shows and you're doing some singing.
I do this funny thing. I call it a song talk. It's an autobiographical, an hour and a half or an hour and 15 minute piece that tells a bit, pretty much what I've been telling you, except, you know, more, it's funnier.
Yeah.
That I tell about how I got to be who I am. How I, you know, just, it, but it's not mostly, it's about me, but it's about me in the world. It's about what goes on. It's a kind of little, I wouldn't call it a history lesson, that's such a downer, but.
It's rooted in another era, but it's
rooted in my life from the time I was about 12 years old and heard Paul Robeson for the first time, which changed my whole life.
He changed a lot of people.
Oh, yeah, right. To pretty much where I am now, or, you know, my years with Holly Near and all that. But mostly it's about the Weavers, what happened with the Weavers, and the questions you've been asking, what was going on at the time, what led to it, you know, how did we get where, and in it, during the time, I sing little bits of the songs that were important to those times and to me and all. And so it's kind of fun. It's a fun piece. And,
do you have any recordings of it? Or
People saying, why don't you video? Why don't you video? Why don't you, you know, it's as if I can do that and do it at the same time. No, somebody else has got to do that for me. No, I don't. But, I mean, I'm thinking about maybe doing a CD.
That would be a nice thing to out there, because when you're gone and people aren't thinking about you anymore, they'll have the CD and they have your
work. I hope they'll have my book. I'm writing an autobiography.
Really? And are you going to finish it?
Well, the proposal is with the agent right now, so I better finish it.
Right. I know there's an ongoing joke with Oscar Brand. He's putting everything off to finish his book. That will never get that will never get finished. It seems.
This one better get finished.
Well, it's a pleasure to talk to you, and you have a website that bears your own name.
Yeah.
And that's
yeah,
that's
just
pretty
my
cool.
own www.ronniegilbert.com.
And that's you're right up there with the technology. Has technology always been of interest to you?
Not at all. Not until it wasn't until I got a computer. And this is all very recent, you know. Learning how to do it and learning, I mean, I'm really self-taught on all of that stuff. I never had a class. I should have.
Right.
But it is such a wonderful thing. I mean, what would I do without email these days? I can't even write. My hand shakes so badly. So, you know, I mean, it's a tremendous tool. And though I was one of those people that said, oh, terrible, it's really going to separate people even
I'll
more.
I'll never get one of those things.
I'll never get I couldn't live without it, no.
You know, it's amazing. If you think about the Weavers, how many little offshoots there are that went on to do other stuff. I've talked to Bernie Krause.
Oh yeah, Bernie. Uh-huh.
Oh my goodness! And you know, he had a momentary contact with the Weavers, which propelled him into so many different places. And
I just saw him just a few months ago. We had a wonderful time together. Yeah.
Yes, he has an amazing. He had an amazing voyage.
Yeah, he did.
And he's still making it.
He does.
I went out and tried to record ants because he told me how to do it.
You recorded ants?
Ants.
Oh,
he
my gosh.
He told me that ants sing.
Is it true?
Well, you know, he has recordings to prove it. So I went out there with my little microphone and I found an ant hill and I shoved the little... You know, I did exactly what he told me to do. I shoved the microphone in the little anthill, and all I could hear was aircraft, cars, my neighbors, the wind. I didn't hear any ants singing.
Oh, my God. You have to go to some place where there aren't.
That's that's his genius.
Yeah.
That he can elicit singing from ants.
Well, he travels to places where there aren't those interferences. I mean... You have to go. They're hard to find, he told me, you know.
Yeah, well, I guess that's the joke, because if you try this at home, you won't have much success. But but it certainly made me think about it more deeply.
Yes, and right.
So, you know, the people that you've come into contact with and worked with have all gone on to other remarkable careers and places. And it's quite a voyage.
Yeah, Pete Seeger's the only one that stayed still.
He's remained consistent in what he's doing.
Yeah. I know he's already. That was a joke. I mean, he's also cleaned up the Hudson River, you know, a few other things.
And
like
he does, you know, that steadfast. He's a remarkable, or another remarkable individual. Do you have much contact with Seeger these days?
Well, once in a while, every now and then we talk on the telephone. Over something. See, he's an anti. He doesn't have a computer. He can't touch any. He won't touch any of that stuff. So
right.
I can't really have any kind. I would have a more extensive communication with him, but he doesn't. He's not into that world. But we talk occasionally. Sometimes it's about a song. Sometimes it's about something that happens. But the reason I have had more contact with him recently is that. I don't know if you've heard about this, but last Thanksgiving, Arlo Guthrie took his annual Carnegie Hall concert and turned it into a celebration of Harold Leventhal, the manager who is the person who has been the hub of keeping folk music and folk people and so on alive in the commercial world.
Right.
You know, concerts, and he's a concert promoter and all. Very, very, very good guy. Anyway... Arlo turned that concert into that. That was last Thanksgiving, and Pete and Freddie Hellerman and I, joined by Eric Darling, who took Pete's place when Pete resigned from the Weavers.
Right, he's an amazingly talented individual.
Eric's wonderful. And Eric Weisberg, banjo duos.
Yes.
You know, wonderful, wonderful musician. Terrific singer, really. He's a... Got a deep voice, and we came together, and as if we were the Weavers, and so I had contact with Pete around that, and I saw him, and I saw Toshi, and we spent a little time together, and that was nice.
So, is there a lot of rehearsal involved in putting a little program like that together for you guys?
Oh yeah. Yes. Oh yeah.
So you have to get together, and it's sort of
yeah.
Like...
Well, we did. We were. We yeah. We We did a bit of that. Yeah. Well, actually, you see, there was a film. There was a film made of that thing. It's a new. It's a film that's going to be released, I think, in January, called "Isn't This a Time?"
Oh, that's
a new film.
That's great.
On that concert, and the Weavers went up there. What's left of us went up there to Toronto to sing at the film festival when they showed that film. That was the first time it was shown.
Wow, so that's going to be out sometime soon. We should keep an eye out for that.
Oh yeah, keep an eye out.
Isn't that a time?
Isn't this a time? I mean, nobody could remember the first one, and I don't know why they went ahead and did it that way again. But.
Well, you know, it's really funny. I went to the Weavers reunion concert at Carnegie Hall.
You did?
You know, the last one.
1980, yeah.
Was it? And you know, I knew who you were. It was, you know, I was. But I didn't really know who you were, and so I went home from the concert and went out in my life. And when that movie came out, oh my God!
You were there.
Oh my
You've
God!
You've been there.
I was there, and I bought a date who had no idea who you were.
Right.
And it was a remarkable. I think a lot of people, I don't want to say exploded, but it had an impact on an enormous amount of people. And it's amazing that this group, this little singing group from 60 years ago, still has an impact on people. It's really
quite remarkable.
It really is.
Very surprising.
Anyway, I don't want to keep you from your day. You were gracious to spend an hour with me rambling about the events that happened.
Well, I did ramble, didn't she? Rambled on.
Yeah. Yeah, but maybe we'll go to part two and we'll talk about, you know, like between 1951 and 1953.
Now you have to read the book for that.
There you go. All right, Ronnie, I'll keep take care and
okay,
thank you so
thanks a lot.
Much.
Nice to talk to you.
Bye. Won't take long. Sing it right once or twice. Oh, lot of me, didn't I shake sugary? Everything I got is done in part. Everything I got is done in part. Pawn my watch, pawn my chain, pawn everything that was in my name. Oh, lot of me, didn't I shake sugary? Everything I got is done in pawn. Everything I got is done in pawn. Pawn my buggy, horse and cart. Pawn everything that was on my lot. Oh, lot of me, didn't I shake sugary? Everything I got is done in pawn. Everything I got is done in pawn.